friendly, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And then he goes on to verse 45, and if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire, and that shall never be quenched, or never shall be quenched. Right. And verse 46, where the worm, their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thy eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell fire. Then in verse 48 again, third time, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. For everyone shall be salted with fire, and every sacrifice shall be salted with salt. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its saltiness, wherewith will ye season it? Have salt in yourselves, and have peace one with another. And we're not going to be preaching verses 49 and 50. I want us to know that the Bible does not say where the worm dieth not. It says where their worm dieth not. So that ties it to somebody. Amen? So it's important that we see that this morning, where your worm dieth not. It's an amazing thing. Amen? So let's go ahead and be seated. The Bible does say, if thy hand offend thee, now I don't know which hand the Bible's talking about, but it says that you're to cut it off. Amen? Know what it says?
Amen.
I don't know if it's the right hand or the left hand. Let's go back and see where it says there. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off.
Right.
That's what it says.
Right.
So you're saying, preacher, that if I'm going to be, a person that believes the Bible and believe it for what it says, literally, then I need to cut my hand off. If it's offending you, amen? I understand what I'm saying. So I don't see any people here that have recently had their hand cut off. I know that when I was in Hong Kong, if you stole something and you were caught stealing, that they would actually come by and cut your hand off. And they had a fire right ready to go ahead and cauterize it so you wouldn't bleed to death. So you could go through the rest of your life looking like a thief. And when I was in India, I found out that it was inappropriate for anybody to go ahead and shake somebody's left hand. I'm not going to tell you why. If you can't figure it out, study it, amen. But people just don't go around shaking people's left hand. And, of course, you don't go and eat with your left hand, and you don't go to the grocery market and buy things with your left hand. Because why? They think that if you do anything with your left hand other than what I'm not going to mention, that you are a filthy barbarian. So if they look at you in that way, you know that probably you haven't really set the thing straight with what you believe. Amen? So if you're ever going to go overseas, make sure that you understand their customs. Amen? Now, the Bible is not talking about us cutting our hands off because of those things. But Jesus is talking to a people, amen, and he uses the word left quite often. I think it's amazing that Matthew 25:41, if you want to turn there, would be Matthew 25:41, as we look into what Jesus wants for us this morning. It says in Matthew 25:41, then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting what? Fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Amen. So everything that's on the left, now I don't want to get into politics, but everything on the left is going to be cast into the lake of fire. That is on the left of Jesus. You all believe that this morning, amen?
Yes,
and there's a lot of people that are living left-handed today. You understand what I'm saying? We're living in this day and age with God-given hands that we ought to be able to use for the glory of God. Can you say amen? And so we have to be careful how we use our hands this morning, maybe not even this morning, but during the week, and let's say all month long and all year long. Are you with me?
Yeah.
God has given me two hands.
Amen.
He's given me a right hand and a left hand.
Yes.
And maybe the left hand is a picture of what's going on in the Middle East, or maybe it is a picture of everything that's wrong on the left, But all I know that God said, at least if one of my hands offend me, then I'm to cut it off. So literally, I'm not going to cut it off. But the Bible says that it's better to enter into life maimed, that's what the Bible says, than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that shall not be quenched. Is that what the Bible says? That never shall be quenched, as the Bible says. Amen. And then again it says, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. So I believe that God is laying out for us in Scripture that somehow we are recognized by God as a worm. Now, worms are disgusting creatures. You know how I know that? Because I've taken my kids fishing, and when I've taken them fishing, they don't like to put a worm on a hook because they're disgusting. Amen. And when you try to put a hook through them, all kinds of stuff comes out of that worm. Amen. You're all really having a good time this morning. Amen. So, you know, worms are really disgusting things. Amen. And I know that I have a tree next to my house. I don't own a tree. And I wish my neighbor would cut it down. But because I'm a Christian, I'm not giving them a hard time about it. But anyway, this year, they had a lot of worms in the tree. You know, those little bag of worms? You know, and tons of them are growing. They're falling all over my house. And they're making little black lines and everything wherever they walk or whatever, however they crawl. And I guess they might be some kind of a moth or butterfly. Am I right? What is it? It's just a caterpillar? Well, don't caterpillars turn into butterflies? Amen. And so could I be, let's say, presumptuous to believe this morning that a caterpillar is a worm? Amen. Now, worms don't turn into butterflies. Are you with me this morning? So you say, where are you getting that, preacher? Well, I believe that the Bible talks about us as being worms. And if I'm a child of God, then I'll never suffer the torture of hell. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
I'll never go to hell. But what I think is amazing about a worm, or let's say a caterpillar, amazing thing, is that if they're left alone long enough, I'm not talking about those things up in my tree, but a real caterpillar that actually hangs in a cocoon, I guess on a tree, is that the way they do it? Are you with me? And so if they hang on that tree, and after a time they get into a cocoon, and that cocoon matures or transforms that caterpillar into what? A butterfly. Does that make sense? Now you all believe that, don't you? So you see this ugly creature, and I mean it's ugly. Now, sometimes you think caterpillars are pretty, but I don't. Amen. Let one fall on your head or get in your jacket or get into some other part of your life, and you're not going to be too happy about it. Can you say amen? So, but anyway, caterpillar gets into that cocoon, and it transforms itself into this beautiful, I guess, what kind of caterpillars are monarchs? Yeah, something like that. They get these beautiful wings. And I mean, they're just lovely to look at. Where we lived in New York, we had a tree that was sitting in the backyard. And I'm going to preach here in a minute, but it get in the backyard. And that thing got so many butterflies on it. It actually, in the fall with no leaves, it looked like the tree was full of leaves. Mm-hmm. Until you walked up to it, and they all fly away. And you thought you were in some kind of Cinderella thing. But anyway, transformation. I understand what I'm saying this morning. So we all that have got saved, we're like that worm. Am I making sense? Before we got saved, we were a worm. We're that worm that was dying and going to hell. And when we do go to hell, we're not going to dissolve. We're going to be where the worm dieth not, is what the Bible says. And in hell, you're going to suffer for all eternity if you don't know Christ as your Savior. But when I got saved, God put me in a cocoon, I guess, if you could. And through the process of salvation, God had taken this man that used to be a sinner that was born in sin, and he transformed me, amen, and turned me into this beautiful butterfly. Ain't I beautiful? As a child of God. Amen. So now that I'm a child of God, God is reckoning with me with my hands. He's talking to me about my hands. Now, I'd rather give up one of my hands than to go to hell, wouldn't you?
Amen.
Come on now. I mean, it'd be that simple. Yeah. I just need to give a hand up.
Sure.
So what's the Lord telling us? He said, well, I'm not expecting you to cut your hand off. Not at all. But I'm expecting you to give up a hand.
Amen.
To give it up to the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And you know why most people don't want to give up anything to the Lord is because they got their hands on too many other things.
That's right.
You understand what I mean? We got our hands on things that we ought not to be handling. Come on now. We have things in our life that we ought not to be. Charles talked this morning about wine. And I'm sick and tired of Christians telling me that it's okay for them to have a glass of wine.
Right.
I mean, I don't care. If you want to drink a glass of wine, have at it.
Amen.
Amen. Get yourself drunk. Enjoy yourself. But I believe that the Bible says we ought not to do those things.
Amen.
And if God has given us a hand, he wants us to use that hand for his glory. Can you say that? He wants us to use that hand that we might be able to do something good for him. And what is that? God wants us to reach out to other people.
Amen.
Now, that's like cutting off your hand, if you know what I mean. Reaching out to other people is not an easy thing to do. It's not. And you say, well, how do you know that, preacher? Because if it was easy, we'd have more people out going soul winning. Can you say that? We have more people using their hand that God has given them to reach out to other people that they might get saved. Can you say amen? Now, I'm not bragging on myself, but we all need to be soul winners. Praise God. Reaching out to God and say, I want you to go ahead and give up a hand. Amen? That means that there's some things you need to give up, like drinking. If you're drinking, you ought to be ashamed of yourself, child of God. There's no excuse. I've heard people say, well, I just got to grow a little more in the Lord. And if I grow a little more in the Lord, God will take that thing away from me.
Right.
Well, no, God is saying, I want you to cut it off.
Right.
I want you to cut it off. He doesn't say, I want you to cut it off next week or next month until you feel like it. He's saying, Christian, I want you to cut it off now. The only reason why we can't go out and tell something about the Lord because we're using our hand for the wrong thing. Can you say
right.
that? And there are some folks that smoke. There are some Christians that smoke. Now, I know I heard about Spurgeon. I think he was a cigar smoker. And, of course, he smoked cigars and he didn't think anything was wrong with it. Amen. Now, I'm not preaching against any of these things. I'm just telling you what God wants us to cut our hands off from. Amen.
Right.
If you want to smoke, go ahead and blow your lungs up. Amen.
Right.
I mean, enjoy yourself until one day you end up in a hospital with some kind of cancer or whatever. But go ahead and enjoy yourself. Amen. But God said that somehow we got to cut our hand off. We got to stop picking up those things that bring damnation on the body. Amen. So you say to yourself, well, I can deal with this thing and I'll get rid of it when I desire to get rid of it. You know, you can't hide anything from God.
Right.
You can hide it from the preacher. You can hide it from the Sunday school teacher. You can hide it from anybody, but you can't hide it from God.
Amen.
If God knows that you're smoking, he said, I want you to cut it off. I want you to cut it off. Well, what about something else? What about cheating on your wife, cheating on your husband? Now you say, well, I wouldn't do that kind of thing. I'm not going to cheat on anybody. Well, come on now. What are you watching? What are you letting your eyes behold? We'll get into the eyes in a minute, amen? I mean, we got to be able to use our hands to go ahead and allow something to be able to be seen by our eyes, but we put our hands all the time out to things that have nothing to do with God whatsoever. Think about how much we use our hands every day for not for God's glory, but for our own glory. Amen. We go to work and we make a living. Amen. Praise God for that. If a man doesn't work, he ought not eat. Praise God. But we use our hands to go ahead and fill our coffers. There's nothing wrong with taking care of our family. Praise God. But sometimes our hands are so caught up in that stuff that there's no way that we can use our hands for the glory of God. God says, I want you to cut your hand off and use it for my service. Could you imagine that? That you never use your right hand again for anything that's wicked? That'd be an amazing thing. Could you say amen? Now, I don't know about you, but hell scares me to death. I don't want to go to hell. And I know you don't want to go to hell. If you're saved this morning, you're not going to hell. But wouldn't it be a great thing to go ahead and say, okay, God, I'm going to cut off these things that I'm no longer going to use in my life, and that is with my hands, and I'm going to use my hand for your glory. It's not easy to shake somebody's hand that you don't know. Did you know that? It's not easy to extend the right hand of fellowship to somebody you don't know. It's not easy to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. You know what I'm saying? You say, well, preacher, you talk about that an awful lot. Well, listen, if the Lord is coming back tomorrow, or next week, or maybe even next year. I mean, we don't have much time left. You know, a little tailor got stabbed 3 times and he lived through it. Can you imagine that? He lived through it that a year later that I might sit on the porch with him and show him how I can go to heaven. Now that boy could have died and gone to hell, and nobody could have cared less about what happens to his soul as a child of God. So think about how difficult it is to cut your hand off. Well, it's not a lot hard if you use a saw. I can cut a couple of fingers off. Remember, that was for God's glory. Yeah, they put them back on, by the way, but they don't work. Amen? And I amen, I cut them off. But you know, that happened to me, and I wasn't doing... Can I tell you about this? Back when the Lord was wanting me to minister, man, I was doing pretty good with doing odd jobs. Did you know that? Making pretty good money. And I was working another shop, making pretty good money. The Lord told me to knock it off. He really did. I mean, he didn't speak to me, that is verbally, but in my heart he said, knock it off. He said, I want you to go out, tell people about Jesus. I want you to go start work. I want you to, I just knew it in my head. That's what God wanted. Amen? And so in the process, I didn't want to do it. So when my son was working with me, I'm working with a big chop box cutting wood. And one day, and the Lord, I mean, it's almost like he spoke to me. He said, now I'm going to deal with it. And that piece of wood that I was cutting hit that saw blade in such a way that I slammed it away from my face. And I jammed my hand right into the chop box. And my son, Chad, had to run me out screaming like a little girl. Not because it hurt. It wasn't all that much pain. But do you know what it's like to hold your own finger in your hand? I mean, when it's attached, it ain't a big deal. So the Lord was dealing with my hands. Amen? Now, I'm not saying that you need to cut your hand off, but I think the Lord would want us to cut our hands off in that way. Can you say amen this morning? So I guess I'm a worm that's saved. And because I'm a worm that's saved, I don't have to worry about going to hell. Amen? God has made me into a beautiful butterfly. And whether you like that or not, I like what the Bible says in Job 17:14. The Bible tells me that most people that are unsaved, let's say all people are unsaved, are worms. And listen to what it says in Job 17:14. I have said to corruption, thou art my father to the worm. Are you there with me? And then what about Job 26? Move a few chapters over. And verse 6, how much less man than his worm?
Right.
And then Psalm 22:6, but I am a worm. Now I'm not reading all the verses to you. You can read the rest later. And Isaiah 41:14, fear not, thou worm Jacob. So I think God is making an impression upon me, at least, about this idea of being a worm.
Right.
And the Bible says again, where their worm dieth not. He's not saying where the worm dieth not. He's talking about your worm.
Right.
He's talking about my worm.
Right.
And praise God, that worm is not going to hell.
Amen.
Amen. So God is saying, listen, I've saved your soul. I made it possible for you to go to heaven. Now all I want you to do is take one of your hands and use it for my glory.
Right.
Could you imagine how God would bless that?
Amen.
Can you say amen? So we believe that man is like the worm. Romans 10:15. You might be familiar with this. Amen. I'm going to get me a hanky someday. And it says in Romans 10:15, and how shall they preach? Except they be sent. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Can you say amen? So what happens to a caterpillar? He's transformed. Amen? That is, transformed into a butterfly. What happens to a child of God? He's transformed. Amen? He becomes beautiful in the sight of God. Now, I may not look beautiful to you, but I'm beautiful in the sight of God. I'm the man and worm turned into a beautiful creature before my Lord and Savior. Amen? And so what does a butterfly teach us? It teaches us that there's a transformation going on in somebody's life. I understand what I'm saying. What does it say in John 3:3? I think you're familiar with that. Jesus answered, said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except the man be what? Born again. He cannot see the kingdom of God. So if you're born again this morning, God has transformed you.
Amen.
Amen. He's took the old man and made him a new man. I'm a preacher in the Lord Jesus Christ. You all believe that?
Amen.
So if my hand offends me, whatever hand, then let's cut it off.
Amen.
Amen. That we might be able to preach the gospel.
Amen.
Amen. Are you with me now this morning?
Amen.
This is so important. Hardly anything gets to the face without our hands.
Right.
Did you know that? I can't get food in my face without my hands. Now you say, well, what about people that don't have hands? It's a little more difficult.
Sure.
But my hands are full of pride.
Yeah.
My hands are always feeding myself.
Yes.
My hands are making it so I have a lower interest in being beautiful in my feet. Amen.
Right.
My hands are dragging me this way and that way, and that way I can't use my feet for the Lord Jesus Christ. God wants me to use my feet. Amen.
Amen.
Wouldn't it be a terrible thing to be a quadriplegic? Or a paraplegic. I mean, that'd be horrible, wouldn't it?
Yes.
You would probably say, God, if I could have my legs back, I would walk for you.
Sure.
God, if I could have my arms and legs back, I would work for you. But do we have to wait to get there, amen?
Right.
Or wouldn't it be greater that we could give those things to the Lord right now today? We must obey the Father with our hands. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We must be able to have the beautiful feet that we're going to get into in a moment to preach the Word of God. You say, well, you're the preacher. No, you're a preacher also. Amen. Now, our prideful attitudes keep us from doing that.
Right.
Amen. Because we're not willing to cut anything off. God wants us to be His children. Amen. He saved us from hell. So what does He want us to give up? He wants us to give up the hand that gambles.
Right. Amen.
He wants us to give up the hand that works without giving God any credit in our life. He wants us to give up the hand that allows us to go ahead and, if you will, make it possible for us to cheat on our wives or cheat on our husbands.
Right.
Amen. And you say, how's that? You may not be going out to do that, but you've got some things in your possession that can cause you to do that. Amen.
Right.
We have computers and we have those things that unfortunately can drag a man's mind into places it ought not to be. Can you say amen? And the only way he's going to get there is to use his hands on the mouse or on the keyboard. I understand what I'm saying this morning. We can allow those things to happen, especially young people. I mean, they have access to things that you and I could never imagine. That is my age when I was growing up. We wouldn't have that kind of access. Amen? They can get on a computer on YouTube and see things that are absolutely appalling. And it changes their minds. It takes them from what they used to be as a child of God to back to being a heathen. Not because they lose the salvation, but they're drawn into that stuff just like we are. Amen?
Yeah.
So God wants us to cut it off. If our hand is reaching out and touch something that's not right, then what should we do? We should cut it off. Amen? Talk to the Lord about it. I understand what I'm saying. So God has given us a hand. He's given us two hands, most of us, to use for His glory. And so we ought to be able to put something out of the way that we can go ahead and give Him the glory. Amen? So if my hand offends me, is what the Bible says, then I need to do what? I need to cut it off. Well, praise the Lord. I'm a filthy worm. I need to cut my hand off. Amen? Now we're going to get to the feet. Can we do that? Now we all want to be justified, don't we? Amen? And I am justified just as I've never sinned. I got saved. God has taken all my sin away.
Amen.
And you're still, if you're saved.
Right.
You know that this morning.
Amen.
Isn't that a good thing?
Amen.
That you don't have to worry about that anymore.
Amen.
That God has taken my sin upon Himself. That I'm not going to hell. I'm a child of God.
Amen.
Praise God. And because I'm a child of God, I am informed of God how I want to live my life.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
And God is telling me over and over again, be careful what you do with your hands. But He also talks about our feet, or foot, if you will. That's an amazing thing, is it not? It says in verse 45, and if thy foot offend thee, do what? Cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life than having two feet to be cast into hell, amen, into the fire that never shall be quenched. Any closing in there? Yeah, listen to this. Where their worm died, huh? And the fire is not quenched. Let it go out. Thank you, Lord, for making it possible for me not to have to go to hell.
Amen.
I often have a fear about hell, but I'm not going there. Don't you have a fear for hell? Could you imagine being shut up in hell for all eternity? And then God casting you into the lake of fire with his own stick. I don't know about you, that's scary stuff.
Amen.
And then it ought to be preached, amen?
Right.
People ought to know. You say, well, I already know it exists. I already know that I could go there if I'm not saved. But if you're saved, you ought to give glory to God, amen?
Amen.
And you ought to give glory to God with our hands.
Right.
You know, how often God wants us to raise our hands with our heads bowed, amen? And give him glory. When's the last time we ever use our hands to give God glory?
Right.
When's the last time we've ever said to God, I love you with our hands, and we want to reach out for God to do something miraculous in our life? God wants to do something miraculous in our life, amen? So let's give him glory.
Amen.
God wants to sanctify our hands. But he also wants to sanctify our feet.
Right.
Amen? So he talks about a foot here. God wants your foot, too. Oh, God, you got my hand, but can't give me my foot. Amen. I need both my feet to be able to get here and get there. I want to take you to Proverbs 4:20. My son, attend to my words. Incline thy ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. We're going to get to eyes in a moment. Keep them in the midst of thine heart, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to their flesh. Amen? Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it is, or are the issues of what? Life. Amen. I have to say this. God has allowed me to survive cancer.
Amen.
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 Praise God. And you say, well, why would God do that? Because God had a plan. And that plan was for me to be in the chemo lab, to be able to talk to people about Jesus. Amen. Place I would never know, probably never go to.
Right.
And I mention that from time to time. So God allows me to walk into that place. Do I like it?
No, I don't.
But there's a point where God can use us. Amen. And he wants me to use my foot as well as he wants to use your foot. He said, put away from thee a forward mouth and perverse lips. Put far from thee. Let thine eyes look right on, and then let thine eyelid look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet. Is that what it says?
Yeah.
Mary, ponder. Shouldn't we think about where our feet are going? Amen. And let all thy ways be what? Established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left hand. Remove thy foot from evil. There's that word foot. So what does God want me to do? He wants me to sacrifice my foot to remove it from evil. You say, well, how is that possible that I have a foot that must, well, we're always walking towards evil.
Oh, yeah.
When you leave church today, you're going to be walking towards evil.
Yeah.
You know why? The devil is good at what he does.
Yeah.
He's going to be drawing you. He's going to be coercing you. He's going to be coaxing you, and you're going to be drawn. You might say, well, I'm going to save my hand for Jesus, but my feet, I can't. I can't stop walking in that direction. Well, one day your flesh will get destroyed. Did you know that? If a child of God that's truly saved believes that he's going to heaven, then one day as he's walking with his feet towards evil, guess what's going to happen? His flesh will get destroyed.
Right.
Amen? And we say, well, how is that possible? Well, the Bible tells me all the time that we can be destroyed in the flesh. We can't lose our salvation, can you say amen to that? But we can continue to live in the flesh, and if we live in the flesh, we'll wonder, why is this happening to me? Because why? I haven't given myself over to the Lord Jesus Christ with my hands first. God wants me to use my hands for his glory, amen? He wants me to at least use one hand, and likewise, he wants me to be able to walk in his glory. Can you say amen to that? That means that somehow I need to have my walking right with God, amen? That means I need to give up one foot. Could you imagine having one hand gone and one foot gone? Boy, you'd be a mess, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
But when you're serving the Lord Jesus Christ, there's no mess there. Now, I know you don't need to be afraid this morning because if you're saved, you're not going to hell. Praise God. But what about all those that are going to hell? Don't you care about them? Don't you care about where they're going to spend eternity? I know we say, yes, we do care. But when's the last time we allowed our feet to walk to somebody and come about Jesus? When's the last time we took one foot and gave it to the Lord and then we brought the other foot? Can you imagine that? Could you imagine walking for Jesus Christ with your life? What a great thing that would be. What a great testimony. And it would almost be like, I've given up a hand, I've given up a foot.
Isn't it hard to do, my friend? I'm going to take you to a couple of verses in Romans. Can you do that? About walking and pondering where our feet go. And there's an awful lot of blindness in the world today, isn't there? There's a lot of blindness in the church today, unfortunately. But let all thy ways be established. The Bible tells us to do that, amen? Psalm 119:105. You remember that verse? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We often say that, don't we? Amen? So is that really the truth? If we have given one foot to God, He's going to be our path. Amen? He's going to lead us. He's going to be our light. But if we've got both feet in the world, my word, how can God command us to do whatever we want to do in our life? Can you say amen? Yeah. Isn't the Lord commanding us to do something? Is He not? If He's commanding us to do it, should we obey it?
Yes,
absolutely. Well, I find in the commands of God that He's telling us that we're to be soul winners.
Right.
He's not telling us to sit back and be a child of God and not allow our hands and feet to be used for the glory of God. What does it say in Romans 3:31? Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. God has given us the law not to get rid of the law, amen, but God used the law as a schoolmaster to teach us that we were sinners born in sin, amen. And then after we became a child of God, God said, forbid ye, we establish the law, amen. So if God established the law, a commandment of God is a law of God, is it not? It's not just the Ten Commandments. We could read Matthew if you want. Go ye therefore in all world. Amen. The Bible says that. Jesus is establishing those words. Amen. He's telling us to go. You can't go if you got both feet in the world. You can't go if you got both hands in the world. You'll never do it. You know why? Because you don't have the power of God in your life. You know what else the Bible says in Romans 10:3? For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. So how do I submit myself? I have to walk towards God. And if I got at least one foot, that's right, it's going to take me where I need to be. You got to stop walking with the left, amen, and start walking with the right. Why? Because God wants me to be in His righteousness to follow His law. He wants to establish His righteousness in my life. That's simple, amen. So let's not walk in the cunning craftiness of men. Listen, if I'm preaching to you wrong this morning, check it out. And tell me I'm wrong. But isn't God calling us to be a soul winner? Isn't God calling us to use our hands and our feet to go ahead and bring about His righteousness? Amen. And what does the Lord say? Turn not to the right hand or to the left, but walk straight. Amen. If we've given that over to the Lord, we can walk the old paths that the Bible speaks about, and we can go ahead and walk those beaten paths that other men and other women have walked before us. Wouldn't that be an amazing thing if we could be that child of God? We have a great thing going on in our church. You say, what is that? We have folks that go solo. Why do we do that? Oh, because it feels good, I guess. Because it's the right thing to do. Oh, God commanded it. Amen. He said, give up your hand. Give up your foot. Cut it off. Make yourself available. Christian, are you with me this morning? Either you're going to sleep or somehow conviction has fallen on our hearts. Amen?
Right.
Praise you. You understand what I'm saying? Amen. So often we look for a bypass. We look for another way. And you know what the Lord talks about when it comes to ways. Amen?
Right.
So where there's one way that goes to destruction, there's another way that goes to heaven.
Yeah.
But we're always looking for a bypass. Think about it. On Saturday, you can go out soul winning. You could go with us. Amen? And you can learn. What a great thing that would be to go out soul winning on a Saturday, or maybe a Monday or a Wednesday. I love to go out with anybody who wants to go soul winning, praise God. But God could use us in a very miraculous and powerful way. Amen? But we have to walk the path that God has set before us. I don't think Jesus went around just preaching and teaching parables. He was teaching people how to be soul winners. He was teaching people how to lead people to Himself. And am I telling you the truth this morning? So He is the one that is the old path that we ought to follow. Praise God. Praise God for the men that walked before us, the men that gave to the Lord Jesus Christ their hands and their feet. Understand what I'm saying? So consider this morning, Christian. Cut your hand off. Give it to God. Cut your foot off. Give it to God. Amen. And then what about the eye?
I love my eyes. I don't know about you, but I like my eyes. Amen. I wear glasses now when I turn 40, and I know I'm only about 55 now. I'm a liar. But when I turned 40, I had to start wearing glasses. Man, that was so frustrating. You know how it is. Doctors try to figure out this eye and that eye. My left eye is stronger than my right eye. I don't know. It's just a mess. Amen? You understand what I'm saying? And anyway, when they got my eyesight worked out, it was good to see again.
Right.
Hallelujah. And now I guess I got, not yet, but I guess I might have to face cataracts. I don't know about you, but if I was getting cataracts, I would go to the doctor and have them taken out, wouldn't you? Come on. I know some folks who did. I know Sharon did it. And she said she could see like a 10-year-old now. Amen. Doesn't have to wear glasses anymore. Isn't that amazing? Wouldn't you like to be able to see clear? Praise God. Wouldn't it be a great thing that you would use your eyes to read the Word of God?
Amen.
Listen to what it says in verse 47. If thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. Ooh. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having what? Two eyes to be cast into the hellfire. That's what it says. We're in the their worm. That's what it says. Their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. Well, that's an amazing thing. I understand it this morning. I want to be able to see clearly.
Sure.
Well, God is asking me to give up one eye. Well, I have one weak eye, so I'll give him the weak eye.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I think he wants me to give him the good eye.
Right.
Amen? Because that's the one that does all the seeing. Especially when I don't have my glasses on. It's good sometimes when you don't wear your glasses because people look so bad. Amen? Amen? When you're in church on Sunday morning, sometimes people look like they just want to bite your head off. Amen?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But praise the Lord, it's only because the Lord is convicting. I believe that, amen. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God. The Lord is the one that brings about conviction.
Right.
Amen. I'm not saying that, you know, listen, I know some of you are thinking, you're not looking bad, but well, I'll tell you, sometimes it'd be good to just take your glasses off. Praise God. Proverbs 30:15. I want to take you there about the eye. The horse leash hath two doors, crying, give, give. There are three things that are never satisfied. The four things say not. It is enough. The grave, the barren womb, the earth that is not filled with water, and the fire that saith not, it is not enough, or it's not, it is enough. And then it's in verse 17, the eye that mocketh at his father and despiseth obey his mother, the ravens of the valley shall pluck it out, and the young eagles shall eat it. Ooh. Sounds pretty rough, doesn't it? Amen. I often had a picture in my mind of what it might be like to be dying somewhere when I was numb, and one of those birds would come down before you're dead and just start plucking your eyes out. Kind of scary. I don't mean to be so graphic. Yes, I do. But that's what we're doing ourselves.
That's right.
Amen.
Yep.
When we allow our eyes to be used for nothing more than to satisfy the flesh.
That's right.
Amen. When God would have us to be using our eyes for His glory, and He's only saying pluck out one eye, you can keep one, keep the bad one, and let one eye be good. I mean, it's going to be hard, amen, to walk the right kind of path, but all you have to do is cover up the bad eye and let the good eye lead you.
Amen.
Now, I know, again, you're not going to hell, and praise God if you're saved. You're not going to hell. Can you say amen?
Amen?
I know I'm going to heaven because I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I believe that the blood has saved me. Praise God. I know I'm going to heaven, but God has something that we ought to be doing in our lives. We don't have to worry about cutting a hand off or foot off, but I think He wants us to give up those things that we can give Him glory and use the eye that God has given us to be able to see the things that God wants us to see. If we're not in the Word of God, we'll never see what God's Word has for us. Praise God. It's good to have an eye focused on the Word of God. Every day when you get up in the morning before you go to bed at night, give an eye to God for a little while. It's like plucking it out. There's one thing that's hard to do in life as a child of God, and that's to read the Word of God because there's so many other things that are capturing our eyes.
Oh, yeah.
Amen? Think about it this morning.
God has given us two eyes, and he wants us to give up one for his glory. So what are we saying this morning, preacher? I think the church has gotten to a sick place. It has. We could have fun this morning and sing all kinds of weird songs on the screen up there and have some drums and all the other stuff. Get all happy. That's what the world's doing. Yeah. Amen. They're getting drunk and feeling good. And we don't want to have to feel uncomfortable.
Sure.
Amen. Well, I think the Lord will have us to feel uncomfortable this morning. Amen. What does God want you to give up? He wants you to give up an eye.
Right.
He wants you to give up a hand. He wants you to give up a foot. Now, don't lie here cutting your hands off and your feet off and say, the preacher told me to do that. Amen. I didn't tell you to do that. Amen. But God wants you to give up one.
Amen.
Amen. God wants you to give up three. That's amazing. God works in threes, doesn't he?
That's right.
Yeah. Give up an eye. Give up a hand. Give up a foot. Stop worrying about what you're going to get out of this life. The only thing you got coming is what we deserve. We got death coming. Amen? Whether you like it or not, we're all going to die. Sooner or later. And God's going to bury us. Well, it's a man's going to bury us. Praise the Lord. Amen? So what is it you're going to give up today? An eye, a hand, and a foot. That's simple. Praise God. And when you do that, you'll find yourself going out telling people about Jesus. God will use you in a very powerful way. Wouldn't that be a great thing this morning? Can you say amen? You say, well, preacher, how do I deal with that? Well, I think it might be good this morning that instead of sitting here with our pious attitude towards things, that we go ahead and give it over to God today.
Amen.
If the Holy Ghost is laid upon your heart, make it heavy in your life, then give it over to God. Amen. What a precious thing it is to be able to give up those things and draw our eyes and draw our hands and draw our feet for the glory of God. Amen. I don't know about you, but I want to do that for the Lord. I don't like being a worm anymore. I don't like being the child of God worm. Amen?
Amen.
I want to be something more for the Lord. So let's stand as we close in prayer. Father, thank you for your precious word and its power. Lord, I pray that, Lord, as we think about ourselves and our life, what is it, Lord, that draws us, Lord, away from your commands? There is so much, Lord, that can be accomplished for your glory. Father, may it be that we would give our hand and our foot and our eye, Lord, to be able to give you all the glory. Father, maybe there's one here this morning that's not saved. Wouldn't it be a glorious thing, oh Lord, for that person to come to know Christ as their Savior? Lord, it would be an exciting time to be able to rejoice with them. Lord, maybe one will come this morning and we'll show them in the Word of God how they can know for sure that when they die, they'll go to heaven. Father, I pray that you would have all the glory and honor as we come this morning. In Jesus Christ's holy name.